You're listening to Talk the Talk with Bill Newman and Buzz Eisenberg, WHMP.
We welcome back to our show Steve Petegorsky, who is a Northampton-based artist, internationally renowned photographer. For those of you who like a little bio, Steve is a graduate of Amherst College. He has his MFA from RISD, Rhode Island School of Design. We also have with us in the studio Naila Moreira, who teaches at Smith College, where she's the director of the journalism concentration at the Writing Center. She, too, is a graduate of Amherst College. She has her doctorate in geosciences. She is a journalist as well as a poet. And we have with us also Paul Gula, who's the gallery manager at R. Michelson Gallery. And you may say, what are all those people doing there in the studio together? So let me start, if I might, with Paul Gula, who's the gallery manager at R. Michelson Gallery, and ask you, Paul, tell us what is coming to R. Michelson Gallery. It's really exciting. And then the story about how this comes about is amazing. But first, what is it and when is it?
Well, the show opens February 1st, although it's up. You can still see it, even before we put all the labels up. It's a wonderful exhibit of photographs and poems based on photographs taken from specimens. And Stephen can elaborate on how that's done. But the images are beautiful and haunting, and the poems are just incredibly insightful and evocative.
And the photographs are by Stephen Petegorsky, the poetry by Naila Moreira. Stephen Petegorsky, This exhibit, this enterprise, comes about fortuitously, as I understand it. Share that story with us, if you would, please.
Sure. Well, I've always been interested in animals, dead or alive, and especially fascinated by taxidermy. I grew up in New York, used to love going to the Natural History Museum and seeing the dioramas with the taxidermy animals and props and painted scenes. And over the years, I've sought out collections of taxidermy because I've often photographed them. And many years ago, when I did that at the Wisteria Hearst Museum in Holyoke, I had actually worked with a collection there that had a lot of fairly decrepit specimens that were ultimately things that the museum was not going to keep. But fast forward to 2014, when I heard of a collection in the biology department at UMass in Amherst. And when I went to visit that collection, which was managed by a wonderful woman named Kate Doyle, I noticed that many of the taxiderm specimens that they had were things I had seen already. And it turned out that the museum at Wisteria Hearst, when they got rid of their collection, the intact specimens went to UMass. So after I basically said to Kate...
Steve Petegorsky, stop there for 1 second.
Sure.
What kind of specimens are we talking about?
Well, what Kate did after I pretty much said, been there, done that, was she said, let me show you the rest of the collection. And one of the things they had in their collection were called cleared and stained specimens, which I had never seen before or heard of. And what they are small animals, reptiles, amphibians, fish, sometimes mammals, that scientists who are studying anatomy and morphology and evolution will put in a solution that clears the soft tissue. And then they stain them using two different stains, which will make the bones or cartilage different colors. So what you end up are these things that are the consistency, really, of almost like rubbery jellyfish that are mostly transparent and that are beautiful to look at. And after I discovered those and worked with them there, I began seeking out other collections. And the part that Naila can talk about is how it came to be that these photographs that I made got to be paired with poems.
I want to ask that. I absolutely do. But before we turn to Naila Moreira, I'd like to know from you why you were so interested in photographing these specimens.
Sure.
You've photographed people. You have amazing range of experience and collections that you've created and photographs that you've made. Why specimens of very dead things?
Sure. Well, thank you, Bill, for those kind words. I'll tell you that, first of all, one of the things I remember from very early on in my photographic work was seeing a book of photographs by Edward Weston when I was quite young, a teenager, and one of the pictures in this book was of a dead pelican in California on the beach at Carmel or Point Lobos or wherever Weston worked a lot. And it was one of the first times I had seen an image of something that was both sad and beautiful at the same time. You know, here was a dead bird. It was sad that the bird had died, but it was so elegant the way he had rendered it. And when I first saw these specimens, they were incredibly beautiful to me because they were showing things on the insides of these animals that I had never really imagined. The beauty, the intricacy, the complexity of their bones and cartilages and other elements was really striking to me. And I knew that if I was going to work with these, I wanted to do something that hadn't been done before. And when I first looked at Googled cleared and stained, I saw that there was a photographer who had worked photographing them, but pretty much just showed them as they were now. And I felt that if I was going to do anything, it had to go beyond that. So that's what led to my experimenting with these and altering them, abstracting them after I took the initial images.
But photographer Steve Petegorsky, I just want one follow-up. I know we bought a barn, and when we bought a barn, it had a line of glass windows that let light into the, and that was called the Clearstory. I didn't know that before we bought that barn. Why is this called Clearstory, this exhibit?
Sure. Because to me, the notion of a Clearstory window, which lets light into a space, was very much the way I thought about what I was doing, because in photographing these specimens, what I do is to light them from underneath. So the light that comes through them from below is what especially illuminates the structures and the colors that are there, that gives me then something to work with that's very different from photographing them without that light coming in and coming through them.
Bill.
And is that the name of the show, the exhibit?
Clearstories is the name that we came up with at a certain point. And it is the name of this this work of the images combined with Naila's poems. And I picked that name in part because I thought that when I looked at these, especially close up from the photographs, they told me stories. They told me stories about the animals and, you know, maybe how they came to be or where they were going in an evolutionary sense. So these pictures to me are like continuing the stories that I hear from what I see.
Well, let me turn now, if I might, from Stephen Petegorsky to Naila Moreira, who teaches at Smith College, is a geoscientist and a poet. And somehow you see these photographs by Stephen Petegorsky, and you end up writing poetry about them, and now there is this, what seems to be extraordinary exhibit at R. Michelson Gallery. Could you connect some of those dots for us, please?
Sure, yeah. I think the first thing I'd like to say is you can hear how poetically Stephen talks about this work, and I think that his sort of the poetry of his vision on these is very much what pulled me into the project. I knew Stephen's work from before. I knew some of his work looking at the meadows here in Northampton. He has a beautiful black and white series on the meadows, and he also does some amazing photography abroad, sort of more journalistic photography, which definitely, you know, touches on some of my favorite themes, since I'm a journalist as well. But I don't even remember why, but I was at Steve's studio one day looking at some of his work, and he introduced me to these photographs of animal specimens. And because most of my work is focused on nature, I became interested in them immediately. And of course, you know, Stephen says that these are storytelling images, and they do tell stories very, very strongly. I think Stephen spoke about the simultaneous beauty and tragedy of dead specimens, or sadness of dead specimens. And I think what this brought through to me was very much an ecological or environmental story of the threats we see to animals today, and the way that we are grieving animals that are often still alive because we see what's coming for them. And so when I was writing poetry about these images, I wanted to reach for some of that mingled grief and beauty, some of the ways that we can celebrate animals through an idea of the longevity of their history, their natural history, the fact that one single animal is a kind of an exemplar of its entire species. And I think that's another wonderful thing for me about these images. The specimens are tiny, but Stephen's photographs are enormous. And so these skeletons become these avatars of being, of their species, of life, of sort of geological history, of paleontology. And I wanted to contemplate that in the work that I did.
Did you write a poem for an image? Did you set out to write a whole collection? Tell us a bit more about that process.
Well, I'd seen the prints in Stephen's studio, and when I became interested in writing about them, Stephen sent some along to me, and I just sort of paged through them and looked for specimens that were not specimens but images, right, that spoke to me and that reminded me of experiences that I had had. I don't remember if I planned to write a series or not. I think I just picked a couple of them and dove in there. Writing the poems came partly from memories of experiences with animals that I have had. I've been a birdwatcher and naturalist and geoscientist for many years. I did an artist residency at the Isle of Shoals in Maine at the Shoals Marine Laboratory there, and some of those poems grew out of that experience, because Stephen's images, many of them do show marine species. And so the combination of that experience and looking at Stephen's images really prompted a lot of thoughts for me. And I've just continued on. It just seems like an inexhaustible topic.
Well, let me turn now, if I might, to Paul Gula, who's the gallery manager at R. Michelson Gallery. Naila Moreira just told us these are large images. How do you put together, because you are brilliant at this, but how do you put together images that are Stephen Petegorsky's photographs with poems that are Naila Moreira's as one?
Well,
how do you do that?
What's really beautiful about the show is that you walk into this room full of dead things, but each one starts to have its own voice. So as you go through the show, first you're struck by the imagery and the image, the skeletal, ghostly images, but they're in poses that make them feel alive. And then as you start to read the poems, you get this cacophony of voices coming from these dead things, and it just becomes this wonderful paradox of life and death and hope coming from these fragile, fragile, beautiful images. But it's one room, so you can walk through it, and things just sort of jump out at you and fade away. And as you go through the show, at first it starts very quiet, but the voices get louder, you know, as you start to go through. So I do encourage everyone to come see the show. It's really, really beautiful. And they've just done
a
wonderful job.
Is there an opening reception, Paul?
Yes. February 9th, that's the second Friday, in conjunction with Northampton's Arts Night Out, 6 to 8 p.m. And come and meet Naila and Stephen and see the show. And it should be a wonderful time.
Tell us again the name of the exhibit.
The name of the exhibit is Clearstories. And it'll be up through the month of February, 1st to the 29th.
We'll be back with more on Clear Stories with Naila Moreira, Stephen Petegorsky, and Paul Gula right after this.
More Talk the Talk with Bill Newman and Buzz Eisenberg coming up right here on WHMP. You're listening to Talk the Talk with Bill Newman and Buzz Eisenberg, WHMP.
We continue our conversation with Paul Gula, who's the gallery manager at R. Michelson Gallery, and Naila Moreira, who teaches at Smith College and whose poetry is on display. Well, not quite sure that's the right word, but along with Stephen Petegorsky's photographs at R. Michelson Gallery. Tell us again, please, Paul Gula, the name of this exhibit, and describe for it just a bit more in terms of its size, its availability, And because then I want to get to Naila Moreira and ask her about the accessibility of the poems themselves. But first, we walk into this room. How big are the photographs? What do we see?
The photographs are about 24 by 24 or so. So they're sizable. You really get a sense of the detail of each piece. And the poems are right next to them on the wall. And I think it invites you to come up close, read the poem, see the detail in the photographs, but then pull back and then take in a bigger view. And the poems echo in your head. Lines from the poems will stay with you. And they're haunting in a way as you see image after image after image of these dead organisms.
And I would add, Bill, that the poems are not just the normal size of a typewritten sheet of paper. They actually have been enlarged photographically to stand on their own next to the larger photographic prints. So each poem in the show is framed at a size of 9 by 20 inches and hangs next to the photographic prints.
Wow. And now, Mara, tell us a bit, if you would, about your crafting of these poems. Did you set out to say something, or were you just moved and what happened? That was a horrible question, but I think
it's very difficult to ask questions about poetry because, as Alison Hawthorne Deming, who's another nature writer, said, she said she can sort of, she knows what she's doing when she's writing an essay, but poems are a little more mysterious. She's not sure where they come from. And I think that's really where the poetic impulse arises, is somewhere deep where we don't really know where it comes from. I think for me as a poet, my poetic impulse often does come from an image from which I elaborate. I like to be able to see something and then follow that story, much as Stephen was talking about, following a story to find what themes or broader ideas are in there. You mentioned accessibility earlier. When I'm writing poetry, I always want to come up with something that you can understand the first time through. I don't look to create a poetry that is hermetic or sealed or difficult to access, but I do want it to have layers and ring, have resonances like a bell that you can discover over time.
And I wanted to ask you, Steve Petegorsky, when you read the poetry that Naila Moreira wrote, did that amplify what you already, your relationship to your images that you already felt? Did it inform you of something you hadn't before experienced? What was your reaction?
Absolutely the latter. It's such a sort of a different way for me to work photographically. It's very intuitive. In many of the other things that I've done, I kind of know when I take the picture, what I want the print to end up looking like. And with these, it's completely the opposite. So I'm starting with something, I'm responding to it in my own, intuitive way. And then when I get to see Naila's responses, which are informed by all that she brings to this as a scientist and as a writer, it very much amplifies and adds to my sense of what's going on with these animals and their place, not just in the art world, but in the universe, really.
Wow, it sounds so textured, this exhibit.
It's been wonderful for me to have that aspect of the collaboration.
Mm-hmm. And I think, my experience as a scientist also really has informed these poems in that I want the animal's actual natural history to be part of this. So depending on the poem, some of them I kind of dive straight in, but others I look up the animal first, I read about it, I learn about it, and I incorporate those details.
And did it change? I guess this is back to Steve. Did it change for you what you thought was in your images when you read Naila Moreira's poetry about them?
Yes, in a way it does, because my take on them is very narrow. It's my own. And so I don't necessarily think at all about what somebody else might either bring to these or how they might respond to them. So, yes.
Well, Gula, where can we see them?
R. Michelson Galleries, 132 Main Street in Northampton. Galleries open Tuesday through Saturday.